Hello, I'm Brian Ferrill, and welcome to PaceIT's session on secure network design elements and components. Today I'm going to be talking about defense in depth, and then I'm going to move on to elements and components of network design. I have a fair amount of ground to cover, not a whole lot of time, so let's go ahead and dive into this session. We're going to begin by talking about defense in depth. Due to the complexity of modern networks, malicious attackers have multiple avenues that they can use to breach network security. This same complexity, though, also allows for security to be placed in multiple areas using different methods. By placing security at different levels and in different places, network administrators can increase the overall security posture of the network. This concept is known as defense in depth, or security in depth. Security should not just be placed on a single spot, as this creates a single point of failure, which should be avoided at all costs. Security should be in place at multiple layers of the network using a diversity of methods in order to create an effectively hardened network. Just as when peeling an onion, once a layer of security is stripped away, the attacker should find another layer waiting underneath. By using defense in depth, you should be able to create a highly hardened and secure network. With that out of the way, let's talk about elements and components of network design. First up is the demilitarized zone, or DMZ. The DMZ is a specific area, think zone, that is created, usually between two firewalls, that allows outside access to internal network resources, as in access to a web server, while the internal network remains protected from that same outside traffic. The external facing router allows specific outside traffic into the DMZ, while the internal router prevents that same outside traffic from entering the internal network, keeping it safe and secure. Another design element is network address translation, or NAT. NAT is a technique used to allow private IP addresses to be routed across or through an untrusted public network. The NAT device, which is usually a router, assigns a public routable IP address to a device that is requesting outside access. NAT has the added benefit of protecting the internal private network. Why is that? The private network's IP addressing scheme is hidden from untrusted networks by the NAT-enabled router, thus making it harder for a hacker to gain access to internal network resources. Now let's talk about NAC, Network Access Control. NAC is a method of controlling who and what gains access to a wired or wireless network. In most cases, NAC uses a combination of credentials-based security and some form of posture assessment for a device attempting to log onto the network. A posture assessment considers the state of the requesting device. The device must meet a set minimum standard before it is allowed access to the network. Common device assessments include the type of device, the operating system, the patch level of the operating system, the presence of anti-malware software, and how up-to-date that anti-malware software is. Then we have virtualization. Virtualization is the process of creating virtual resources instead of actual physical resources. Hardware, operating systems, and complete networks can be virtualized. A security advantage to virtualization is that if the virtual resource is compromised, it can be easily taken down, recovered, fixed, and then brought back online in very short order. Although I would recommend figuring out how it got compromised and filling that security hole. Subnetting is the logical division of a network. That's a single block of IP addresses being divided into discrete, separate networks. This can be done to match the physical structure of the network, as in if your network only requires enough addresses for 100 nodes and it doesn't need all 254 nodes of a Class C address. Subnetting can also be done to increase the security of the network by segmenting resources by need and security level. Since I just brought up segmenting of resources, let's talk about that a little bit more. Security can be increased by segmenting a network based on resources and security needs through the implementation of virtual local area networks, or VLANs. The segmentation can be done based on user groups, as in a VLAN for the sales department and another VLAN for human resources. The segmentation can be done based on resource type, as in a VLAN for file servers and another VLAN for web servers. Commonly, segmentation of resources is accomplished with a combination of both user groups and resource type. The use of VLANs supports a more secure, layered approach in the network design. In modern networks, it is not uncommon to need to allow remote access to local network resources. Remote workers often need to access resources that are located on the main business network. This requires the use of remote access technology in order for it to happen in a secure manner. Remote access can occur using telephony technology, as in using a dial-up VPN, or through the use of a different type of virtual private network. In all cases, secure protocols and methods should be used in order to ensure the security of the local network. For example, one of the forms of extensible authentication protocol, EAP, should be used when allowing remote access. Now that concludes this session on secure network design elements and components. Today we talked about defense in depth, and then we concluded by discussing some elements and components of network design. On behalf of PaceIT, thank you for watching this session, and I hope to do another one soon.